We choose between sanity or insanity. That's it. It's a choice. So what could be better than to spend time considering that choice? If we choose to see insanity, that's what we'll see. If we choose to see sanity, that's what we'll see. That's it. We're not trying to bring sanity to insanity or bring insanity to sanity. We're not trying to knit them together. We're not trying to come up with a hybrid of the two. Okay. We're simply choosing one or the other. Because sanity is entirely sane. Okay. It can't be insane. And the denial of sanity is insanity. Since sanity is total, whole, unfragmented, seamless, perfect, flawless, there's no place for it to be insane. Therefore, if you reject it, you will have an entire situation of insanity. It won't be sane at all. So we're not going for a little bit of sanity. We're going for the whole enchilada, the whole picture. And it's just a choice. That's it. So if we want to look upon an insane world, universe, we will. It'll arise, and all these insane events will take place. If we say to the Holy Spirit here, you take that. I know you can deal with it as far as reassuring everyone to choose sanity, and then you will deal with that. I'll just choose to see sanity. And then sanity, you don't see a universe the way that we've seen it before. It's a new vision, a mental vision. And you might say the universe has disappeared, vanished, because everything is in relationship to truth. Everything is in relationship right now with sanity, with truth, with timelessness. So you can't really say there's a universe, because the universe is motion, right? And events and change. Whereas the vision of sanity, there's no change like that. Nothing is being affected by anything else. Nothing is being worked on, modified. There's no modification taking place by anything else. Everything is pristine, immaculate. It's different. So there's two different visions that we can see. We can see the vision of insanity, which is this universe that we're seeing now, or the vision of sanity, which is a timeless vision of timelessness. You might say the world disappears, all people disappear, the world disappears, the universe disappears, vanished. The notion that there is such a thing as the universe, that of all these impermanence and all this taking place, that's gone. It's gone. So there's no more death, there's no more suffering, there's no more trauma, there's no more attack, there's no more threat, there's no more vulnerability, there's no more modification, there's no more destructivity, there's no more decay, there's nothing of that, it's all gone. Now we might ask, how is that possible? Well, the Holy Spirit gives this vision to us. Remember, the only issue we have with dreaming hypotheticals is continuity back to reality. So this vision of sanity mirrors reality and enables us then to set down all hypotheticals. This whole insanity is a hypothetical. We're saying, what if reality weren't real? Okay, that's insanity. So we're hypothetically imagining what would it be like if reality wasn't real? What would it be like? Well, we see this universe. We see these bodies. We see this world. We see this nature. We see all of this stuff. But it's all hypothetical. It's our imagination based on what if, meaning not the human imagination, spiritual imagination of mind. Spirit said, look, what if I want to be prime creator? So what if reality wasn't real and I could be prime creator? Then the mind presents this hypothetical scenario of what if. Just completely fanciful, complete whim, total insanity. But we don't have to, we're not bound by insanity, we have free will. So we can always also say, what if reality was real? What if reality is real? What if reality will always be real? That's also hypothetical, because we're not directly experiencing reality when we're saying that. What if reality is always real, will always be real? What if reality will always be real? From that is a hypothetical scenario where that's being imagined of this flawless, timeless vision of timelessness symbolized for us. The overlay, beautiful overlay, stillness, total stillness, vision of perfect stillness, nirvana, not moving, without movement. That's sanity. Why is it sane? Because it is mirroring reality. See, reality doesn't change. It's immaculate. So once we get used to this mirroring of reality through hypotheticals, then we say, I don't need hypotheticals at all. And then you set them down, and then hypotheticals are, you're finished with hypotheticals altogether. So first, we chose the hypothetical of what if reality could be changed? What if reality isn't real? Then we decide that's no fun. We don't want that anymore. So let me choose the intermediate step. What if reality will always be real, can't be changed, will always be real? And that gives us this vision of perfect stillness, a perfect thing in itselfness, of the death-free vision, the vision free of all harm, the beatific vision, the face of Christ, the vision of oneness. We get that. It's still a hypothetical, and then we set that down eventually when we're completely accustomed to it and understand it, very familiar with it. Though this is the consideration that we should spend our time here while we're here. We should spend our time in consideration of this choice. It is simply a choice, 100% a choice. It's not a process. It's not something that nature brings about or anything like that. It is simply a choice. Spirit chooses which hypothetical to entertain. Should we entertain the hypothetical of what if reality isn't real or won't be real, which is the same thing, and or what if reality will always be real or is real, same thing, because reality being real is eternal and can never be changed or unreal at any point. Which hypothetical do we entertain? Which one do we choose to entertain? So the Holy Spirit has this vision of oneness, this vision of flawlessness, immaculate timelessness, thing in itselfness for us. It says, choose this, here, this, and don't worry about the other insanity. The Holy Spirit will take care of insanity as far as using time appropriately to consider making a new choice. We don't have to worry about that. That's not our function. Our function is just to accept, to make this choice. That's it. We don't have any other function here. Having made that choice, then the Holy Spirit can point that out to others, that this is possible. You say, see, look, you can choose. But as far as trying to see insanity and help others that way, no. We're finished with that, because you cannot help. You cannot help by looking at insanity and trying to make it real. That's impossible. It's a choice. Insanity will always be insane. The hypothetical of what if reality isn't real will always be insane. It'll always be suffering. It'll always have the horrible, terrible aspects to it. Always. No matter what we do, we're just shuffling the deck. Every time we talk about empowerment, we're empowering something here. We're also disempowering something here. And it's this shuffle game, the shell game. It's a shell game that we're doing. And we keep doing the shell game. You see those street hustlers doing the shell game? Like, where's the little, they have something under these shells and they move them like this. Is it here? And we keep just doing that. It's a shell game. Always it will be atrocious. Always it will be a nightmare. Always it will be death-based, fear-based, loss-based, attack-based. So all this notion of trying to bring happiness and peace to insanity is totally insane. That is insanity. That is insanity. Insanity thinking that it can get better or cure itself is insanity. Because the premise is reality isn't real. So how can you, based on that premise, not suffer insanity and fear. It's impossible. And people just don't think that through. We don't think that through. Part of the consideration is to think that through and see, nah, it's not possible. It's ridiculous to entertain such foolish notions. That is insanity. Insanity thinking it can cure itself somehow is insanity. Insanity thinking it can get better is insanity. Insanity thinking it can be something other than what it is insanity. That is the insanity. The Holy Spirit just says, choose sanity. Don't keep struggling with insanity. Of course, in insanity, all these horrible things are happening. That's what it's for. It's symbolizing the attack on reality, that reality can be destroyed, can be attacked and destroyed, or has been attacked, will be attacked and destroyed. It's symbolizing vulnerability and threat. It's symbolizing that reality is vulnerable. Innocence can be attacked. That's what it's picturing. That's what it's acting out, which is just complete insanity. But there again, as long as we have this premise, it's completely futile to struggle with this. So the real spiritual path is to consider the choice. I say the real one, the one that's actually effective. That's it. The other stuff is nonsense. It's total nonsense. Waste of time. Total waste of time. And coming into this world, we come into a world that is just rapidly insane. And it's saturated, this world is saturated with the insane notion of how they're cures for insanity, but keeping the premise, but they can be cured or made better or improved. This is the madness of this planet. Come in here, come to this planet, and you are just bombarded by these delusional mindset of insanity here. So it's very difficult for anybody to come here and to be able to focus, say it's just a simple choice, that's it. Very difficult. I do searches on the internet all the time, trying to find, try to find the simple truth. It's like looking for a needle in a haystack. I say, it'd be a lot easier if I could just find somebody else doing this. I say, okay, you talk about it. But can't find it. Can't find it. It's a simple choice. It's only a choice. It is only a choice. So give the universe to the Holy Spirit. Say, here, Holy Spirit, it's your job to deal with the insane and to explain and to work with them in this process of consideration. That's your job, but it's not my job. My job is just to make the choice. Once I make the choice, the universe is gone. It's disappeared. Bodies have disappeared. There are no things, as it were, that we talk about as things in relationship to nature, arising as something that is a process. There's no process. There's no process. There's no universe. Process is gone. There's nothing but stillness. So I cannot, it's not my job to see insanity and talk about it. No, it's gone. That's our job. Our job is to make the choice and experience this stillness, abide in this stillness, this timelessness. The Holy Spirit's job is to work with time, right use of time. So the Holy Spirit can tell us how to help it out. Do this, do this, do this. But it's not our job to decide what to do, because we don't see insanity anymore. We're not aware of insanity anymore. It's not arising. We're not perceiving it. We're not perceiving death. Death vanishes. The universe vanishes. What is the universe but death, as a matter of fact? What is insanity? Death. Death is insanity. So choose insanity. Death vanishes. Can't find it anywhere. And it's not our purpose to find it and heal it or cure it or fix it or make it better. No, 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 no. That's insanity. That just reinforces insanity. Sanity is a self-reinforcing belief system. Everything that arises just reinforces it. It's just kind of like a system that just reinforces itself continuously. What else can it do? What else can insanity do but reinforce itself continuously? Otherwise, surely we would see like, this is going nowhere. This is no good. But insanity always seems as if it's going somewhere, that it's getting somewhere, that it's progressing, that it's very progressive. Insanity views itself as highly progressive. Has to, doesn't it? It has to. And those who say, now, wait a minute, we've been down that road before, there's something wrong. Then those are people, they're titled, well, they're not progressive enough. Something, they need to be more progressive. In other words, they need to be more deluded by insanity. But the wiser we get, we say, now, wait a minute, we've been doing this forever, and it's just more of the same nonsense. Insanity is reinforcing itself. That's it. All that this universe does is just insanity reinforcing itself. That's it. Death reinforcing the notion of death. That's all that's happening in the universe. Insanity reinforcing itself. What do we need that for? It's useless to us. Useless to reality. Entirely useless to reality. So what we want is we give the Holy Spirit permission to speak to our minds directly and convince the mind, say, yeah, make this choice is okay. Convince the spirit that this making this choice of choosing sanity, having the universe, having death disappear is the right choice, is what we want to do, and it's not a fearful choice. And so we engage in consideration. The right use of time in this world is to engage in this consideration so that we get closer to actually deciding that, making this decision. Closer meaning this, realizing it's a decision, not a process. This is right use of time. How we go about this consideration varies greatly, and each one is different. Everyone's unique in how they go about it. So you cannot codify it. You cannot institutionalize it. It's something that is unique to each one. Each one has their own unique path of consideration. But the end result is exactly the same. The end goal is exactly the same. Perfect stillness is perfect stillness. It's the same perfect stillness. It's just different places, different times. They describe it with different words. For instance, let's say you see a still pond, and it's perfectly still, this pond of water, so still. Someone will say, the pond is still, the water's still. Another one will come and look at it and say, the water is not moving, no movement. Same thing, right? No movement, still. Same thing, nirvana, no movement, stillness. Some will say it's quiet, perfectly quiet, perfectly serene, perfectly tranquil. Some will say, totally peaceful, the water's totally peaceful. All talking about the same water, the same situation. Some will say beyond all motion, beyond all movement, transcending movement, or one undivided whole of stillness, complete oneness of quietude. The quietude is oneness. You say, it's all, the pond looks like one. See, there's no ripples or anything. That too. So there's all these different ways to describe it. It's talking about the same situation, which is simply a choice. We either choose to look upon insanity or sanity. That's it. If we have free will, so if we choose to look upon insanity, insanity will arise to look upon. That's our creativity, literally. If we choose to look upon sanity, sanity will arise. Again, both are hypotheticals. Looking upon, in reality, we are reality. We are reality. We don't look upon reality. We are reality. But when we take the idea like that, what if reality isn't real? Then we first look upon insanity. We're looking upon unreal situation, an insane, imaginary situation, a hypothetical situation. Then because we're not that, so we're looking upon that. So the remedy is to look upon sanity. And then finally, drop looking altogether, and we are reality. So these are the considerations. That is right use of time. Right use of time is to question, do we really want to look upon time? Time means change, means measurement. Time is the measurement of change. Do we really want to look upon the measurement of change? Or do we want to look upon this stillness, which is not, it's supernatural stillness. It's not the stillness of nature, okay? See, we wrongly think that the serenity of nature is we're talking about some sort of stillness like that. It's not, no. It's a supernatural stillness. It's thing in itselfness. It's the insane insanity cannot grasp it. Of course, how can it? You can't bring sanity into insanity. It's not possible. So really, you could throw out all explanations and just say it's a choice. It's a choice. Throw out all psychology, all of this stuff is not necessary. It's simple as we're talking about, a simple choice of what do we want to look upon. Both are unreal. Both are unreal. It's entirely up to us what we look upon, we choose. Death is totally unreal. And looking upon this, the complete absence of death with the hypotheticals, it's still a hypothetical, it's still unreal, but it solves a continuity issue for us. Again, continuity issue is the only issue we really have to feel like is making us truly jittery. That's what makes us truly jittery. We're jittery about that. So there is no process explanation, procedural explanation, process explanation. You know, how did you get this stillness? No, it's a simple choice of what you want to look upon. There's no process involved in that. A choice. We say, well, we're looking upon stillness, death-free vision, because that's what we want to see. We decided that we want reality to be as it is, that we accepted reality as it is. We want to accept reality as it is. So this solves a continuity issue for us. We know that, so that's what we're looking upon. It is true that both insanity and sanity are equally unreal, because in reality, there's no issue of sanity or insanity. Reality is reality. It can't be anything else. So how can you make a meaningful statement and say, well, reality is sane? You cannot make such a statement. That's a meaningless statement. If there's no possibility that it can be anything other than what it is, why are words needed at all? They're not. So you can't say, well, reality is sane. That brings up the notion that it could be insane, or there's some possibility of insanity. There's not. There is not. The vision of this supernatural stillness. It's supernatural. So let nature be nature. Don't try to change nature. Forget it. It's a colossal waste of time. I mean, it's unbelievable what the insane are doing in this world. Frantically studying, researching, trying to change nature. That is a colossal waste of time. Let nature be nature. Let impermanence be impermanence. Let death be death. Let all this attack be attack. Let all this terrible struggle be what it is. It's insanity. It's a picture of insanity. So let the picture of insanity be the picture of insanity. You know, don't try to change it. That is insanity. Trying to change insanity tries to change the picture of insanity into something else. That's insanity. Instead, look at another picture, because that solves a continuity issue. Insanity will never solve the continuity issue. Can never do so. Never. So it's useless to us. It's really useless. We keep trying to improve it. That's when in Rome, do as Romans do. I even try to improve it. Because if you don't, people will think you're nuts or you're lazy. You know, you get stigmatized if you don't try to improve it here. So forgive yourself for trying to improve it, because when in Rome, do as Romans do. You know, you have to at least give the impression so that people don't label you, stigmatize you. At least up to a point. Sometimes in times and places in this world, it was not stigmatized to accept the vision of stillness, timelessness, death-freeness. It wasn't stigmatized. Now, it's stigmatized worse, I think, than it's ever been stigmatized in the history of this planet. This planet has been under an absolute blitzkrieg of assault from insanity. Unprecedented on this planet. It's probably happened on other planets, other places, because we were warned that what's going to happen here. So the warning, it's something that happens in insanity. Insanity attacks itself and reinforces itself, reinforcing. So we've had this incredible reinforcement of insanity on this planet, off the charts, completely off the charts. I was going back yesterday, going back through the music that I used to listen to, all the music, and I just looking at it and said, my God, how terrible that stuff was. How utterly reinforcing of insanity it was. Just terrible stuff. Oh, sure, it's got some catchy tune and rhythm and all this kind of stuff, but it's just awful. It's like this planet just had all the sewage dumped on it, you know. Toxic waste. This planet has become like a toxic waste site, toxic dump, where the virulently insane have come here and just dumped all their virulent insanity upon this planet. So, this planet's an insane asylum, to say the least. It's really an insane asylum, where the extremely insane come to bear witness to insanity. This world's like a pigsty, where the pigs just love to come and wallow in the mud here. It is a variantly insane place as far as witnessing to insanity. Now, when you have the vision of timelessness, vision of Christ, vision of oneness, it is said that there are no bodies there. Does that mean this body disappears? Well, it disappears as a body, as a definition, as a body. Things, all things disappear, but it's the nature disappears. But things are reinterpreted. They're seen differently. They're no longer seen as part of nature. It's a supernatural vision. So there's still, everything remains that we are accustomed to, but it's been reinterpreted. So bodies are no longer bodies. Things are no longer things. All this, it's a complete blanket reinterpretation. And we think, well, it's how's that possible? Well, we don't have to worry about that. It is possible. And in hindsight, it's understandable and explainable. Because I can say this because I've seen those in this condition, and I know it's possible. And they testified to it, absolutely. Those who want to see damage have to see bodies, don't they? And things, they have to see things. Things that are vulnerable. They have to see vulnerable things. Those who want to accept reality as it is, that hypothetical then, what if reality will always be real? There's no need whatsoever to see any damage. So there's no need to see any vulnerable things. So you can still see thing in itself, but there's no vulnerability. There's no vulnerability to that identity. And again, it's a total vision without exception. So there's no way you can explain it to insanity, because it's without exception. It's not, well, just this thing is that way. No, it's everything. It's a total, without exception. It's totality without exception. There's no vulnerability there. There's no damage. There's no decay. There's no death. There's none of that. And of course, insanity will say, well, that's how could that be? It's not true. It's not real. Yeah, but neither is death and damage real. That's not real either. So it's a question of which dream do you want to dream? Insanity tries to think as if this insanity, there's some reality to it. There's none. So what authority or basis does it have to say that you should choose it over some other dream? It has none. It has no authority or justification whatsoever. It keeps claiming that there's some validity to it or something. No, there's not. There's no validity to any dreams. Equal non-validity. That's why I give no judgment to any dreams whatsoever. None. Just gave the Holy Spirit created the Holy Spirit to make right use of time. That's it. But no judgment. They're all equally invalid. So on what basis does insanity claim that we're supposed to see it? It has no basis at all. None. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let the insane deal with insanity. That's their choice. That's their free will. And let those who decided to choose a different vision, choose that vision and see that. That's their free will. It all seems very simple and very easy, and it is. So the right use of time is to consider this issue. As long as you're still seeing time, the right use of time is to consider this choice. Okay, which am I going to choose? Just keep telling yourself it's a choice. That's all that it is. Not a mandate. It's a free will choice. One solves the continuity problem. One doesn't solve the continuity problem. One dream solves the continuity problem. One dream doesn't solve the continuity problem. So which dream do you want? All dreams are equally unreal. But which is useful? Which is useful. So insanity is saying that it's useful. How is it useful? Doesn't solve the continuity problem at all. So how is it useful? It's only useful because insanity claims that it's creating an alternative reality, so that if reality is destroyed, we'll be able to shift to this alternative reality. And so it's claiming that this is useful. But again, reality cannot be destroyed or changed in any way, so it's totally useless. Well, saying, well, if it were so. But in accepting reality as it is, we will know it's totally unnecessary and we'll completely stop dreaming altogether. So any work we've done on some alternative reality will vanish, because it won't be sustained by imagining anymore. So it's a useless thing. What it's really saying is that we have to perpetually, forever dwell in this alternative, quote, reality, it's a dream, alternative reality, forever. Because as soon as we decide not to dwell in this alternative reality, quote unquote, alternative reality, it will vanish. Once we go through the intermediate step of choosing a different dream, supernatural dream, then once we set that down, all dreams will vanish for us. None. There'll be no more alternative reality. No, not even a memory of it. Not even a trace of it will remain. So what insanity is really demanding of us and lobbying for is that we remain in this fantasy, alternative reality, fantasy of impermanence and death permanently. That's what it's telling us, permanently. It doesn't tell you that, does it? And it says, no, just stay away. It hides this fact by saying that you're the life of your body, functioning of your body will come to an end. And it says, when that function of the body comes to an end, you're free, you've done your service. Not true. It's lying to you. It's absolutely lying to you. Because you will continue dwelling in this hypothetical alternative reality in other subtle forms and functioning in other subtle ways. And then you will also at some point take on a more grosser body, another physical body, and you will just keep aimlessly drifting through the different realms of this fantasy alternative reality of existence. In this body life, the flesh life of the flesh, and the afterlife of non-flesh, you would just continue on drifting through this vast fantasy, hypothetical. And presuming that this is your home. It's not. It's a hypothetical alternative reality based on our desire to be prime creator, therefore necessitating reality being destroyed at some point. It's not destroyed now, but we posit that it will be destroyed at some point. So we have this alternative reality all set, and yet again the price we pay is dwelling in it, or imagining ourselves be dwelling in it. Because if we didn't do that, we'd realize the reality will always be real, and we wouldn't have the slightest need to imagine this, and we would stop imagining it, drop that, and wouldn't be a trace left of all this. All of this universe, is not going to be a trace left of it. Once we all decided to choose a new idea, choose a new hypothetical, and then set all hypotheticals down, there won't be even a trace of it left. Not even a memory. So again, what good is it to dwell in such total impermanence, knowing that it will always be completely impermanent and on the brink of vanishing altogether? Crazy. What kind of security? None. So eventually we wise up to insanity, and say, wow, insanity, you're asking me to do the same thing over and over and over and over again. Insanity says, no, this is different. But I say, no, it's the same. It's like every year you plant flowers in the spring, and you tell insanity, wait a minute, I planted last year and the year before and the year before and the year before, and you always say it's the last time. And it'll say, no, this is different. You're planting different flowers. You know, you're different color flowers this year. It's different. I say, no, it's the same planting. Putting a plant in the ground, watering it, and it growing. There's still a plant. It's still, everything's the same. Just superficially different color. But that's not still doing the planting. It says, no, it's different. So insanity keeps telling us that superficial external variables are different. Got a little bump there. But they're not different. There's no change in the content of the meaning. Insanity always is devoid of meaning, devoid of real content, which is why it places so much emphasis on the external. And again, we're all prone to do that, myself included. I want to keep up appearances. In fact, the closer you get to choosing a new hypothetical, the more prone you become to putting on a show, external show, because you're afraid that people might realize that you're not ready to make your escape. It's like, let's say you're a prisoner, a convict in a prison. And you're planning an escape, and you figured out a way to escape. You know, first you're really angry prisoner. You say, I want to get out of this place. I want to. You're screaming at the guards, banging on the bars, and everybody knows you hate being here. You're gonna get out of here, and the warden knows, and everyone knows that you're gonna try to make a break for it. And then finally, you figure out a way to get free. You find a way to say, oh my gosh, I know how to get. What do you do then? Do you keep up this bluster about, I want to get out of here or something? Now, the tendency is at that point to become a model prisoner, right? And say, I'm sorry, guys, I'm broken. I realize I can't get out of here, and I'm finished here. You know, I'm finished with my efforts, and from now on, I'm going to be a model prisoner. I'm sorry that I really bothered you like that, and I'm changed, had a change of heart. And so you act like you're not interested in getting free. So there's a tendency when you find out the way to freedom is you put on a big show that you're really not interested in freedom, that you're interested in the superficial. That's what happened to me. I can understand it. Understand that. That's what happens to us. So we overcompensate the other way. Because we don't want the warden looking too closely at us. So if we just kind of blend, you know, just let me just be like all the other prisoners. In fact, let me dress up my cell real nice. Real nice. So I have a really beautiful jail cell. And the warden looks and they say, oh, wow. He must be pretty happy here with that. He's really resigned to staying in this jail cell, so he's made the jail cell really nice, you know, dressed it up. So oftentimes, when we're getting close to freedom, we will put on a show that we're not really interested in freedom, that we're really superficial, engaged in superficial stuff. Very, very true. You can't always judge a book by its cover. For instance, Mary Magdalene was a notorious hooker, and apparently she repented at some point. It may have been that she was indicted for freedom. Vision of stillness, and yet she was so worried that people might be aware of that, then she acted out the opposite, you see, to throw people off the track, that kind of thing. So you say, why did Jesus have these friends who were kind of notorious, some of them for being very bad, very worldly? Because they likely were overcompensating. They were being good convicts, throwing people off the track. People look at Magdalene and say, ha, there's no way that she's interested in freedom. Are you kidding? Very worldly, terribly worldly, you see. But that may have been just a facade, a cover, to obscure, throw everyone off the track so the world wouldn't get their hooks in and try to, you know, dissuade them from it. See, that's possible. I don't know. Those are just, you know, biblical characters. I'm illustrating a principle there. But in our own lives, which is more important, that principle's at play too. I'm still doing it. I'm aware that I'm doing it. I'm aware. So people think, oh my gosh, you know, how could they be interested in freedom from insanity, freedom from the universe? He's paying so much attention to the universe. Yeah. So don't feel discouraged or guilty if you're like that, because that's par for the course. That's normal. I went through a phase of dressing really well and external appearance, focused on external appearance kind of thing, to try to say to the world, oh, I'm not interested in escaping the universe. Oh, no, I'm not. Look, I'm interested in being a leader of the world here, helping everybody and all this stuff, you know. And so went through that. Of course, when you do that, you tend to get involved with people, the wrong kind of people, which is, so it's a problem. You tend to get involved with idols. You get guidance from those who are good at wasting your time. Now let's say you're a convict, again, back to that convict, and you find a way to escape, and now you say, oh my gosh, I better not let the warden know that I'm still interested in escape. I'm going to be a model prisoner. So what do? You go find model prisoners and hang out with them and adapt yourself to the way they are. You take the cues from them. Okay, how do I be a model prisoner? Because I really don't really know really how to do that. And then, but these model prisoners, they themselves may be absolutely resigned to their enslavement, you see. And so you end up hanging out with those you don't really want to hang out with, and taking the cues from those you really don't want to take the cues from, and then you end up getting entangled with those you don't want to get entangled with. And that's what happened with me. The goddess of enslavement. I said, my gosh, I don't want anyone to know that I'm about ready to escape. So let me find one who has interest in escape, and let me serve them. So nobody will have any idea. You know, they think, oh, he's really full bore working to help the world, make the world more attractive, that kind of thing. But you know, I wasn't. That was just a cover. But you get entangled with this stuff, and then they expect you to do what they're telling you to do, even though you don't really want to. And they think that, oh, here, I'm gonna. You need to do this and this and this, and it gets worse and worse and worse. And at some point, you gotta say, wow, enough's enough. So it's easy to get pulled down into bad situations here in the world, just trying to cover your true intentions, which is freedom. Because this world here views freedom as insanity. What else could the insane do is view freedom from insanity as insanity? Insanity being self-reinforcing belief system. Anything that is not part of that is viewed as insanity, and insanity views itself as sane. Okay? So you're in this world, you don't want to be viewed as totally insane, trying to help others. So you know, you tend to try to appear to be insane, but that's a dangerous game, especially at this time in the world where sanity is so demonized in the world, unprecedented, that it becomes a very dangerous game at that point. So what we're trying to do is trying to normalize sanity here, at least to a certain extent, so people realize, hey, you're not alone in choosing sanity. And the frustration is there's not enough of that. Very frustrating. Because I feel like I could drop my overcompensation game if that were possible, if there were those that were truly sane here and have established, normalize this and establish some momentum in that way, but it doesn't seem to be happening, which is why I'm it seems like relocation is the appropriate step to take. Most of the light, so-called spirituality, enlightenment, all that is what insanity will allow here. Okay, let's be honest about it. That's how I see it. Insanity will allow certain side trips, okay, that it will smile upon and say, yeah, that's okay. If you can play the game of enlightenment on this side trip, that's okay, no worries. So it allows all these side trips, these little eddies and whirls in the current of insanity, that it doesn't bother insanity. It's okay. But it's not real freedom. It's not real, the true vision of stillness. So there's a lot of that stuff going on, an amazing amount of that going on right now. Very little of the genuine stuff going on. Because the pressure now is so severe. It's crazy severe. So the best that I can see at this point is relocation. Getting off of this planet, getting out of this planet at this time for a while. I don't know if we would come back or something else. That's possible too. I don't know. But it seems as though at this particular juncture that insanity is particularly virulent right now. And it is true that when it becomes this virulent, that it may be wise thing to temporarily withdraw. Like Napoleon going into Russia in wintertime was stupid. It was a virulent winter. Okay, you don't do that if you're trying to advance. You don't do that. In other words, that's just an example. But that, be humble. Don't think that it's always possible to have a robust witnessing program in this world. doesn't seem to be working right now at all. It's getting worse. It's getting worse, a lot worse. Because the spirituality that's being churned out is, again, it seems as though it's a side trip that insanity smiles upon as kind of a faux salvation. It's kind of like in a prison where the prisoners are like frantically working to escape and the warden pretends not to notice, okay? But what the prisoners are doing is they're tunneling from one jail cell. They're going through a wall. The prisoners are chipping away at this wall, a concrete wall or something, and they're hiding it. They got a poster over it or something. And then they're constantly chipping away every day at night, secretly, and the warden pretends not to know anything about it, all right? And they think, wow, we're really getting free. It's amazing. And then they finally make a breakthrough in the wall. I think, enlarge the hole, and they've got an escape route, right? So they climb through the hole, and where do they end up? In the next prison cell next to theirs. Okay, they've been tunneling through the wall into the next prison cell, and the warden, of course, knew all along. So the warden wasn't worried about it. The warden allowed it. He said that's a nice diversion of their energy and use of time. Let them think they're heading towards freedom, but they're really just going into the next jail cell. So it seems like a lot of the spirituality on the planet right now is like tunneling in the next jail cell, and the warden is pretending not to, I'm not worried about that stuff, it's okay. So it flourishes, it thrives. But the real freedom, insanity, no way. That's what it's extremely worried about. So there's all this massive side trips in this world, and we all assume this is spiritual freedom, spiritual truth, and it's just we're just tunneling into other jail cells. And then the theme in the prison is, let's all get together as one. Let's all spend our time tunneling into other jail cells so we can say, hello, hi, I'm living in the next jail cell next to you. And then the other prisoners go, oh yeah, I see you too. Hey, we got a new connection, huh? We got a little tunnel between our jail cells. Wow, maybe we could all be one. We can spend our time tunneling through our jail cells so we can all shake each other's hands, say, hi, how are you? Good morning. And hey, we're happy, we're this is freedom, this is wonderful, we're all one, kind of stuff like that. It's ridiculous. It's totally ridiculous. Choose the vision where there is no jail cell, there is no prison, there is no warden, there is no need for tunneling. Bugs. So that's how I see what the world is. Everyone's just tunneling into other jail cells. Almost everyone. That's the trend. That's the fashion. And actually choosing a division where there is no jail. Oh, no. No, see, people say, no. We want the jail. We just want to escape from it. You see, we want the jail. We just want to escape from it. What they don't realize is when they choose a jail, the entire universe is a jail. So as you're all this tunneling, you're just like a gopher just going digging in the ground. You're not getting free of the universe at all. You're just moving through it. That's not freedom. That's not freedom from the universe. That doesn't solve a continuity problem at all. And to say, well, there's nobody that needs the solution to the continuity problem is ridiculous. How about the one that gave rise to all this impermanence? They certainly need the solution to this continuity problem because they're still giving rise to it. And to say, well, there's just all this impermanence is here, but there's nobody experiencing it or something, again, it is nonsense. That's a side trip. That's a side trip that the ego, that insanity smiles upon. It says, oh yeah, you don't have to choose. There's no one to choose anyway, it says, the ego says. There's no one to choose, so how can you choose something different? There's no one to choose. Spirit is to choose. Spirit is choosing this universe as a dream in the first place. So it has to choose another dream to solve the continuity issue. So there's definitely a chooser. There's definitely an experiencer. Absolutely there is. And it's super important. It's just not the quote-unquote I or the body self, the personal self, of course. But there's still a chooser. There's still an experiencer. It's still vitally important. We can never abdicate what we are. The idea, well, there's no self, there's no chooser, there's nothing. It's just all this is just spontaneously arising and that's all there is nonsense. It's total nonsense. It's a side trip that insanity smiles upon to divert your effort and intelligence and clarity and time, use of time to a futile endeavor. But all the while you're thinking that you're using it in the right way, time in the right way. So you think you're going towards freedom, but you're really not. Waste of time. But what happens when you realize you've been wasting time? That's the great realization, the great moment where you say, ah, where you can choose to get angry and deny or to be grateful and say, oh, thank you. Thank you, clarification. That's wonderful. I'm so glad that I see I've been wasting my time. That is wonderful. Because now, in seeing that, I'm not going to continue. How else can you correct wrong use of time, bad use of time, wasteful use of time, futile use of time, except by first seeing that it is futile and that you have been doing it? Of course you have to see that first. And then react to it like, oh, thank you. My gosh, I'm so happy to see my mistakes. So happy. I live for that, you know. Just show me my mistakes. Show me what I've been doing wrong. Show me my errors. Show me how I've been wasting time. That's the greatest thing possible. Let me see that. At least right now. The greatest thing possible is, of course, to choose a vision of Christ, a vision of oneness, a vision of timelessness. The death-free vision. And then that enables us to set hypotheticals down, which is then that is the ultimate. And then we experience reality about which nothing needs to be said at all. But for right now, recognizing how we've misused time is super important. It's like, eureka, hallelujah, when you see it. Oh my gosh, I've been on a side trip. That is great. How wonderful. Oh, all these other people are on side trips. Wonderful, I see it now. You know, it's tremendous. So there's two devotees. One will take it one way, another will take another way. One will be super angry at the teacher and say, the lying deceiver is trying to undermine my spiritual path, and get super angry and defensive and attack mode and feel that you've been attacked and all that stuff. The other will be like very, very happy and grateful and say, this is the best day in my life. I've finally seen how I've been wasting my time all this time. Wonderful. Now I won't keep doing it. Just a little difference. It just hinges on a little difference, doesn't it? I always expect people to be able to get over that little gap, you know, that little trouble, but they don't. They don't, which is amazing because they're so close. All they have to do is a slight attitude adjustment, like, oh, thank you. You know, now I see. I'm so grateful. Now I see. I've been wasting my time. Wonderful. I guess that the people feel that they have no choice but to keep wasting their time, so that they feel they're angry because they won't be happy then. You know, that every day they realize, oh, I'm wasting my day today. Oh, I'm wasting my day today, and every day is a complete waste, and they feel no option. So it takes a maturity and a clarity to see it and say, wonderful, grateful, because you know there's an option. If you don't know there's an option, of course, it will seem like an attack. Because you say, oh, you're just trying to make all my days feel like useless to me, awful. So it does have to be said in the right context. And there has to be a maturity there. And if the maturity isn't there, you know, then the people just demand, they say, hey, can you please support my side trip and tell me that this is the right use of time? Well, what are you going to do? You don't want people to feel they're attacked. So what I've seen with the real teachers is that somehow they agree, like, yeah, everything's great. Everything is wonderful. It's all good. It's all good. However, here's something that's even better, kind of thing. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to choose differently, use their time rightly. It doesn't mean that necessarily. It just means that you cannot press truth upon anyone who's not ready for it, because they will be a backlash. They will feel as if their life has been rendered meaningless. So if you wonder, why do some people get help and others don't? Well, that's why. Is you don't come across the great teachers and they don't help you out unless you're able to respond in a positive way to them pointing out how you're wasting your time, how you've been wasting it. So, because you will see it very clearly, and then you'll say, oh, that's great, thank you, wonderful. I've been trying to figure out where am I going wrong here, and now you show me that. I'm so happy about that. Like, why am I still choosing to see death? You know, I can't stand it. I hate impermanence. I hate death. Why am I still choosing to see it? You know, that's the thing. Why am I wasting my time? And the when you see it, then you'll be happy. So, you know, the Holy Spirit is willing to show us the truth. We have to be able to take it in the right way. Otherwise, we'll feel like we're being assaulted, like we're being kind of like, the demand is being made that we be unhappy. You know, seeing that what we've been doing, seeing that insanity is always going to be unhappiness, is scary to some people because they don't see any other option. They don't see the way out. They don't realize they can choose a different idea, different hypothetical. And how does one realize that? Well, for me, it cannot be done purely through explanation. Explanation is reinforcement, is useful reinforcement. It's a supporting role. Explanation is a supporting role. The real role comes from an internal experience, which, for instance, in my case, I had in 1978. I had an internal experience, a number of them, that convinced me there was another perception. Absolutely. I was not bound to this one. And I knew for a fact, because I saw it, I experienced it. And so then I just realized that this is true. And so then I was able to take instruction, help, and clarification, and relate to it in a way like, where I'm happy to uncover my mistakes and uncover confusion and clarify. I'm happy to do it, eager to do it, by and large. So, of course, then a spiritual path unfolds from that standpoint. But if one has never, even for a moment, seen you know, freedom and seen that there's another vision we can have, then it's only at the level of conceptuality and explanation, and then they simply get into word games. It's all conceptual, mental conceptuality. It's useless. They'll feel attacked. They feel they're defending their happiness. In other words, saying that insanity is all there is, and we have to figure out a way to be happy with it. And they don't want to see their mistakes. So they want to try and point out in verbal, semantic play, you know, who's sane and who isn't, as if it's some contest, endurance contest, as if truth is some kind of endurance. Whoever has the most endurance must be speaking truth, kind of thing. And so they just try to wear down. Useless. Totally useless. Whereas those who have had a glimpse, they have to be reminded of this fact and to stand on that. And don't get into these conceptual contests. A verbal contest. It's a complete waste of time. And on the other hand, sometimes those people who do that, again, are overcompensating because they really are about to choose freedom, but they're covering it up. They're playing the good prisoner. They say, oh, look how conceptual I am. You know, look how I'm involved. I am in argumentation. Look how I'm wasting my time. See, I'm not interested. So there's that too. However, it's easy to tell in the slightly long-term basis of what's what, because the upset and anger and stuff is not real, and it's not really, it's not true, you know, it's not it's not virulent. You can pretend to be aggrieved, but it's pretty obvious that you will not really, you're not truly aggrieved. I get mad at the teachers and gurus and Holy Spirit a lot, but very quickly it blows over, and I say, well, I wasn't really angry, you know, it's just, you know, it's gone, forget it. Right now, let's go for it, totally. I mean, you don't have to overdo the charade, you know. Don't have to overdo the charade. You don't have to try and harm yourself or harm others or anything like that. But in today's age, today's situation, it's possible, you know. It's what I'm seeing is it's becoming so taboo. Freedom's becoming so taboo. The freedom to choose, once again, is becoming so utterly taboo on this planet right now that those who really want to choose freedom will feel like they have to hide it to an extraordinary extent, which could really involve harming others, you know, to show, no, look, I'm into violence and gruesomeness and attack too, you know, and then they'll overcompensate and do too much of that and end up harming others and themselves. So again, relocation is a possibility because of the virulence of insanity on this planet right now. Just as a relief, I mean, those who have chosen freedom and want it, they don't want to have to be overcompensating. It's a burden. They don't want that. It's better to relocate where there's not so much taboo and pressure, and then they'll drop this compensation act, you know. They won't be dangerous to themselves or others. You know, it's possible, like the Sanhedrin, Caiaphas, and Jesus' crucifixion. It's possible that... For example, that they were so nervous about Rome seeing how much they wanted to be free of Rome. In other words, they were prisoners of Rome. Like a prison analogy again. They didn't want Rome to think they had the slightest inclination towards anything resembling freedom. And of course, Jesus brought in this great gospel of freedom. And they said, oh my gosh, if we make Jesus welcome in our country, our place, Rome's going to be able to pay attention to this and realize that we really want to be free from Rome. And so we got to hide this desire for freedom. So by crucifying Jesus, then Rome will say, oh, they're not interested in freedom. That kind of thing. Overcompensation. Overcompensation, you see. That's possible. That's an example, you see, how you can look at history in different ways. They may have been so jittery about their own desire for freedom and terrified if Rome caught wind, really knew how much they desired to be free, Rome would come in and destroy them and lock them down even worse. So they said, man, we just can't have this Jesus. We got to pretend like we hate him. We got to pretend like he's the enemy. And then Rome will say, oh, you see, they're good little... prisoners, they're good little prisoners. And then maybe Jesus said, you know, saying to Barabbas, hey, come on, don't rile Rome up. Don't show him how much you want freedom. Come on, lay low. And when in Rome, do as Romans do, and plot your true escape. Your true escape, which is to choose a different vision. Choose the vision of freedom. Choose the vision of the death-free vision. The timeless vision of timelessness. That's a real freedom. That's freedom from the universe. Freedom from nature. Choose that. You see. So, but Barabbas may have been one of those who didn't want freedom at all, wanted worse enslavement, and he was hiding that fact, overcompensating for that. So acting out, he didn't want any freedom, he wanted enslavement, and he's so afraid that this will get found out by those who want freedom, that he's desperately compensating for that by trying to say, I want revolution, I want freedom. Of course, it brought, you know, annihilation. Which is what he must have been seeking in the first place. But he was pretending that he wanted freedom. See, so history is not what we think it is. History is really a series of overcompensations. We don't really know what happened in history. our history is complete bunk, really. Really it is. The heroes and the villain, all this stuff is nothing like what really happened as far as motivations and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody is overcompensating in this world. All games. Everyone's playing games. It's a lunatic asylum. And you can't tell a book by its cover, that is for sure. They should, they should ban heavy machinery on Sunday, don't you think? I mean, got this some huge engine whining, like a chipper, some whining, some power thing. It's just like, sounds like a chipper. On Sunday, come on. Give us one day of the week where we can have some quiet. At the least. If you don't give us even one day, that's nothing. Now, on a planetary level, you could also have overcompensation going on. You know, it's possible. It's possible that we really do want freedom, this world, planet, and we want to give up this idiocy of trying to change, to fix insanity, and yet we're so afraid that this be known to perhaps the interlopers that are here now, that we're pretending to go along with them frantically, you know, trying too hard to be Romans, as it were. Yeah, we're like dressed up in the finest togas and sandals and doing everything that, you know, we're like trying to ape the Romans, as it were. And maybe we're not really, maybe this is overcompensation. That is, you know, possible, but also probably very unlikely. It would be quite a surprise if that were so, but I could accept it, say, okay, just an all overcompensation. Because really, if you're really for freedom, you are actually taking the most tremendous efforts towards using your time in the right way. And even when you're overcompensating, you're going to be making great efforts. Even when I was doing a lot of overcompensating, I was still very much intent upon true freedom. And the current was still paying attention in that way, you know. But I got caught up in the fear of, like, oh my gosh, I don't want anybody to know that I'm going to get free. I don't want anybody to know. I want to feel that's the thing. I want people to think that's the last thing I could possibly be interested in. The last thing possible is that him? Are you kidding? He's so worldly. He can't possibly be interested in spiritual salvation. Not him. That's the impression I wanted to give. I wanted to give a worldly impression to the world, so people would not, on the slightest inkling that I was working towards choosing a new hypothetical. And it worked. It worked. I'm sure nobody has the slightest idea that I'm interested in any in freedom at all. At least, you know, people in the, in my area and stuff. No inkling. I try to keep it that way. I'm just a worldly person. Just also play dumb, like I'm just kind of a knucklehead, play dumb, absent-minded, kind of incompetent, incapable, of course, of freedom, impossible. That's all overcompensation. Just trying to fly under the radar. So maybe you're so wrapped up in flying under the radar, you've forgotten your quest for freedom a little bit. That did happen to me. I got so caught up in it, I did, my efforts lagged a little bit. That is true. I was so worried about how can I possibly function in this world in a state of sanity that I got caught up in trying to overcompensate and appear to be very worldly. And at that time, my efforts did lag. That is true. But still, there was still momentum going beneath the surface. But I was trying to keep it beneath the surface, kind of thing. I didn't want it coming out, you know, in the world so people could see it. I wanted to hide it. So maybe some of us in the world are in that phase of trying to hide it. And I'm just saying, you know, don't. Maybe ease up on your efforts of overcompensation at this point. And spend more time on right use of time and consideration. Don't overdo your overcompensation. Just keep using your time rightly. But I can see how right now people would be overdoing their compensation, overcompensating, because the taboo's getting worse and worse and worse. So there may be some very brilliant people in the world who know what true freedom is, who know that they simply need to make a choice of whether they see insanity or sanity. But it's so taboo to see sanity here that they're overcompensating and pretending they have no interest at all in that. It's almost assuredly that way. And maybe those who have really no interest in freedom are feeling uncomfortable about that too, and so they're pretending to, you know, be interested in some tunneling through the next jail cell wall. And like, oh yeah, I'm really interested in freedom. Look at this, you see, where it's not really choosing sanity. Strange situation. It may be. Let's say there was a relocation. Those who relocate might be a tremendous surprise to the world. Crazy. The world say, well, that's crazy. All these worldly people left. They must be going to be damned, you know. These people are, they must be going to their damnation, because look how worldly, these are worldly people. They're not spiritual people. They can't be going to dwell with Jesus. That's crazy. And look at all the ones that have stayed. All these spiritual people have stayed in the world. They said, oh, you see? So if this was a genuine relocation, these spiritual people would have gone. Not true. Not true at all. Again, I just pointed this out to you. Again, it's very possible and even probable that the people are most desirous of freedom and most attuned to choosing a vision of sanity. They may be overcompensating and appearing to be very worldly at this time in this planet. And those who really don't want to choose a vision of sanity, who want to remain a vision of sanity, they just want to rule choose a vision of insanity, they just want to rule insanity and be the leaders of insanity. They're putting on this big show of spirituality and enlightenment and stuff like that, faux enlightenment at this time. So of course, if there's a relocation, they will stay here, and the worldly people who are overcompensating will go. And then the world will misinterpret that. They'll say, insanity will misinterpret it and saying, oh, those who have left, they must be going to their destruction because they're worldly people. They're not spiritual people. And because look, all the spiritual people stayed here on the planet, right? So it's very tricky in that regard, very tricky. I'm sitting on the cat's bench, and this is the time to have its morning snooze. It's a noontime snooze. It starts here at this time and continues on for most of the day. No, you're gonna have to wait. Come on, you have to wait. So, this is a tremendous breakthrough. I've never seen it this way before. And it's been very confusing to me. Because I have seen that the insanity interprets relocation as going to our destruction. That those who relocate are going to go to a very harsh prison or some terrible situation. And I say, why do they think that way? They've got some plausible explanations for that. I say it's not true, but it's plausible. Now I've shown why it's plausible. Because insanity says, wait a minute. Look at the evidence. All those in this world who seem very spiritual, they didn't go. A lot of those who left, they seem very worldly. Therefore, it's not possible that they're going to a death-free realm to dwell in this fabulous paradise. It's crazy, because if that were so, if there really was this death-free paradise, certainly the spiritual people of this planet would have left and gone there. You see? So that's plausible. But again, if you don't understand this principle of overcompensation, you will get tripped up by that. You will get tripped up by it. I mean, I can appear to be a very worldly person, easily. Just get a haircut, put on an incredibly sharp suit. I got a bushel full of ties and dress shirts and great shoes, and I can look like a bankster, you know? Easy. I used to look like one, as a matter of fact. I can look like anything. I can look that way easy. I can look like a very worldly person. And that's just, again, a cloaking device. So many of those who will relocate will have these cloaking devices of worldliness because they don't want to be seen as relocators, because that's so taboo on this planet. It's like a crime. It's like a severe crime. It really is. I mean, from the standpoint of insanity, that is like a heinous crime. You're separating from the oneness of humanity. As if you're separating, you know. It is so ludicrous. Separating. You're choosing to go back to the realization of oneness. That it was oneness is always been the case. And you're just dealing with the continuity issue to that. You're not separating at all, it's just the opposite. It's those who remain insanity who are trying to separate from reality. So they basically say, you're trying to separate from our alternative reality. How can you separate from nothing? You see, you cannot. It's ridiculous. It's insane to look at it that way. So this taping has been a breakthrough. I always have a breakthrough in taping. You know, I don't know what it's going to be, to tell you the truth. I really don't know. It's just making the effort to share and communicate that it happens. I had no idea this would come up. This is tremendous. Because this has been one of the greatest puzzlements I have, is this issue about relocation, and is it safe? You know, is it valid? And then thinking like, well, maybe it isn't. If the spiritual people don't leave, how could it be valid? See, but again, the spiritual people on this planet are on a side trip that insanity smiles upon. Because it's kind of like diverting their efforts, and they again may actually not want freedom at all, so they're overcompensating, pretending, oh, look how much I want freedom, but oh no, really, They're just hiding the fact that they're diehard non-freedom advocates. And they're kind of worried because there is some spiritual teaching on the planet. There has been. And they're afraid that they don't want to hide for that as much as possible. So they say, oh no, there's nobody to teach here. There's nobody here to teach. So don't bother me. That kind of thing. And of course they're not going to relocate to where the vision of sanity is very untaboo, very welcome, to a place where it's very welcome. They're not going to relocate there. Are you kidding? They want to stay here at all costs. So insanity's idea of who would relocate and who wouldn't is completely verklempt, crazy, insane, of course, because it doesn't recognize this principle of overcompensation. So we don't know who would relocate. They'll probably all be cloaked, cloaked in worldliness. Very likely. And then the insanity will say, look, all the spiritual people remain, therefore that means the golden age is coming and everything's going to be wonderful here. Not true. Not true at all. Not true, okay. Like I said, in my investigations of a lot of the spirituality on this planet, what I have seen is most of those who are acting that they're spiritual or enlightened or something are actually diehard, have a diehard attitude of not getting free. Okay? So the fact that they would remain here on this planet doesn't mean some golden age is coming. It means sacrifice is coming. All right? And they're giving a false impression to the world that their spirit, the spirituality is true and every, don't worry, everything's fine here, everything's wonderful. It's not. And it oozes out of them. I'm very keen on seeing it and observing it. It comes out that they're really diehard devotees of death and impermanence and this alternative hypothetical reality. They're diehard advocates of that. They just want to see themselves as being some great advocates of this. And they have the capacity to make it true or to help structure this alternative hypothetical reality and being spiritual motivators of that effort. They don't want freedom at all. So of course they're going to stay here. The fact that they're staying here does not mean that everything is going to be wonderful on this planet. Just the opposite. It means that sacrifice is coming, global sacrifice, which is the purpose of these times, is to have a big pep rally, as it were, of death. Try to make death real. Try to help us get accustomed, more accustomed to the nature of this hypothetical alternative reality, which is death-based. So, situation starting to clear up now. Very interesting. Very interesting indeed. Wow, that's quite a mouthful there. Wow. You know, those who say you can be happy with insanity are insane. You cannot. Those who say, well, don't worry, there's no one to be happy or unhappy in the first place. That's insanity. And that's just keeping it. It's an excuse to keep insanity, isn't it? Just an excuse. Say, well, I don't have to choose a different hypothetical. I can just say there's nobody to be happy or unhappy here, so it doesn't matter. That is insanity. There is a continuity issue that's been solved, and we have to choose a different hypothetical. We must choose a vision of timelessness. There's definitely one that experiences a vision of timelessness. It's definitely important. It definitely resolves our concerns about continuity. And we definitely will set down all hypotheticals eventually altogether and realize that we never left reality, that we are reality. How can reality leave itself? It cannot. It just say, well, there's nobody there to experience it. It's dissociation. It's kind of like saying, yeah, everything's gonna die and get destroyed, etc. But it doesn't matter because there is no you. You know, that's called dissociation. That's what people use when they're going into battle. Is they say, well, they have this feeling like that they're nothing, and so the destruction of their body, destruction of their bodies, it doesn't matter. Because they're not experiencing it anyway. That's not the vision of sanity. That's not the vision of timelessness. That's dissociation. That's not it. That's a warning sign that destruction is coming, because people are trying to train themselves in dissociation, really. That's how I see a lot of the spiritual teaching, is training in dissociation. And I never think about, well, who am I, or is there I, or something. It doesn't matter. What's important is what's being seen. Is death and impermanence and time being seen, or is timelessness and death-freeness and flawless permanence and thing in itselfness, is that being seen? That's the only question. Who is seeing it doesn't matter. It's being seen. How we label or define the seeing doesn't matter. It's being seen. It's being experienced. Dreams are being experienced by the dreamer. Okay? It doesn't matter what we call the dreamer. The dreamer's still there. So it was a waste of time worrying about that. So we either choose a dream of impermanence or a dream of permanence, a dream of death or a dream of life. A dream of time or a dream of timelessness. The dreamer is still experiencing whatever we choose. It's the dreamer is experiencing it, as hypothetically, as if it were so. So it doesn't matter what we call the dreamer. I mean, ultimately, the dreamer is spirit. Whether we call the spirit I, or the self, or whatever, it doesn't matter. It's the content of what's being experienced that matters. Is it solving the continuity problem or not, is the only question. If it's solving the continuity problem, there'll be this deep sense of relief, release, and remembrance present, and effortless gratitude and bliss in all circumstances. Because they're not seeing the world that we are, the insane, are seeing. They're not seeing that. They're not seeing death or impermanence. They're not seeing it. So it's not like they see it, but they somehow found a way to be happy about it. No. That's not it. It's not like they're seeing a universe of all this nightmare, but they've somehow adjusted to it. No, they're not seeing it. They're seeing a flawless, incredibly beautiful picture of everything, thing in itselfness, total stillness, total timelessness, flawless, seamless, shining with freshness and invulnerability. That's what they're seeing. So of course they're going to be, they're happy to see that. But if you see that in this world at this time, be evil will say, are you kidding? Look at all the horrible stuff going on. You know, how can you possibly be so inhumane, you know, not to respond to that and react to it? And this is the global community where we all share all the gruesomeness with one another, saying, hey, did you hear about this news and this and this and this? So, like, we're aware of every, all these terrible things taking place around the globe constantly, and we're all tweeting and sharing all that. And the info world, ain't it awful world? And if you're not aware of any of that stuff, you're irresponsible, super irresponsible, and maybe even insane. If you don't see any of it, you think we must be totally insane. Whereas other times, other places, other cultures, there was a real recognition that, hey, no, these people who see the vision of Christ are sane. They're the ones that are sane. We're the ones that are insane. But that's been flip-flop now. So, coming back to our seminal point, which is the overcompensation. And how overcompensation has clouded the waters about relocation. And how relocation may very well be necessary at some point coming up as the world gets extremely disempowered and it becomes so taboo to entertain thoughts of freedom and desire for freedom, desire for sanity, that people begin overcompensating too severely. That is a real possibility, very strong possibility, which is not a good thing at all. From my own overcompensation, I can tell you it was not a good thing. It's something that I regret, you know, it's something that I don't like. Distasteful, you know, and if overcompensation becomes really, you know, too extreme, that's not a good thing. That's why it seems reasonable. Relocation seems reasonable to me. That those who are really desirous of a vision of sanity, a dream of sanity, would benefit greatly from a relocation. I mean, it can get down to the point like Jesus 2,000 years ago. We don't want to go through that again, where teachers of truth end up getting attacked by those who really want freedom just because they're overcompensating, pretending that they don't want it, you know, because they're so scared. That's not right. I don't want to be part of that. There's got to be a better way than that. But to me, relocation is a better way than that. Because it's going to get down to the fact you can't function here anymore unless you bow to insanity. You won't be able to function here. You won't be able to feed your family. You won't be able to, you know, move around. You won't be able to do anything. You'll be trapped. And people under those circumstances, Jesus told Peter, you're going to deny me three times. And Peter did. You say Peter was what really desirous of freedom. And yet, you know, once Jesus was gone, it's like, whoa, you know, these people are going to crucify me if I admit that I'm desirous of freedom. So you say, no, I'm not, I don't even know the guy. I have no idea what you're talking about. I'm not one of those. No, in fact, I'm just the opposite. I hate that stuff. See? So that, it can get to that point and worse, where those who are most desirous of freedom, most desirous of a vision of sanity, we'll end up like St. Paul crucifying those who and ratting them out, you know, saying, oh, I know who's desirous of sanity and freedom, that one, kill him, you know, that's St. Paul, that's what St. Paul is doing. St. Paul is very desirous of freedom, and is terrified that this might get found out, so he ended up being the lead prosecutor of the Christians, early Christians. That was overcompensation. And then Jesus spoke to him and said, hey, you know, what do you, what, you don't have to keep doing this. Come on. And St. Paul then realized, oh my gosh, I've been overcompensating. Wow. And he said, forget it. I don't want to do that anymore. And so it could get that way and get worse than that these times. Where like those who are desirous of vision of sanity will be like hunted down by those who are most desirous here but are terrified at overcompensating. You know, crazy situation. Crazy situation, really. All that could be remedied by relocation. Absolutely. That would be a blessing for everybody. Everybody. Nobody really wants to overcompensate to that. They don't. They just think they got no choice. They got no choice. That's why I've always preached relocation. I feel this is like super important. And I don't, will it happen or not? I don't know. But I'm continuing to work on this and keep giving it air. It's like a plant, you know, put it in the window, give it water, give it fertilizer, give it sun. See if it flowers. We had this orchid, incredibly beautiful orchid, my gosh. A different kind that just had blooms all the way up and down, a big central stalk and blooms all over. This is a gorgeous. And all the blooms dropped off eventually, and we kept the plant in the window in the sun, and just, I said, you know what, it's not going to, I doubted it was going to ever flower again. You know, the orchids usually don't. Just kept it in the same situation. And lo and behold, this year, beautiful flowers have come back. So, you know, I'm not giving up on this relocation thing. It seems like it's very important. People talk about the false rapture, you know, false, because those that they think are spiritual in this world won't be going. Yeah. It's very likely that's a true rapture. You know, people want, well, the Christians don't go. They say, well, okay, that's false. Not true at all. I see many, many Christians, not a complete generalized statement, but many are absolutely dead set against the vision of sanity. What they want is to make the vision of insanity their permanent home. That's what they're after. So, of course, they're not going to accept a true rapture at all, true relocation. Absolutely not. So the fact that a lot of Christians wouldn't go, it doesn't make it a false rapture. Not at all. Now, of course, some Christians do want sanity. Absolutely. It's a mixed bag. There's always exceptions to generalizations, but that doesn't mean generalizations can't be useful. They can be very useful. So this notion of false rapture, hey, you gotta, you know, let's look at that. It may be just the opposite. Just the opposite. Again, those that we assume would go if it was a true rapture are most likely to stay. If it was a true rapture, they're most likely to stay here. And those we don't assume would go are most likely to go in a true rapture. Those who are overcompensating, pretending to be model prisoners here, right? I imagine people would be absolutely shocked if I relocated and say, well, why would he go? He's got nothing to do with any spirituality or anything. So... so, oh, it must be false, that kind of thing. So we may have it upside down and backwards here in this world. The first rapture may be the true one, and then the one that the people say, oh, no, we're waiting for the real one to happen. It never happens, and then destructivity comes upon the world, because that's what they really want. That's what they really want. They want to revel in the power of destructivity. That's their mana, you know. That shows, aha, you see, we have the power over reality. This is a separate reality. And look how separate it is. Look how different it is. See, we don't have any interest in going back to the real reality. This is what we're interested in. This is what we give our attention over to, you know. It's, again, insanity is self-reinforcing. It is self-reinforcing. So we're headed for a huge reinforcement of insanity. So, of course, relocation. Why not? But I don't have any information about it. occasionally I get dreams of hey, you gotta go, you gotta go somewhere, you know, just get ready to go and evacuate, but I don't know where to or exactly how it takes place. I had one last night. But rarely do you hear people speaking about relocation, especially the spiritual, so-called spiritual people of this planet. Rarely do you hear that, which I find very strange. Or if they do, they talk about the false rapture or something. And, you know, they're really trying to undermine the whole rapture thing, actually. It's such an obvious topic to consider that it's really strange not to hear it more spoken about. Again, which I interpret that as meaning that there's a lot of posers in the world who really don't want true freedom, who are pretending to be spiritual heavyweights in this planet as overcompensation to hide the fact that they really want nothing to do with it, with vision of sanity. Okay, Comcast is here. I'm going to wrap this up right now. I guess it's time. They're going to try to figure out why their service is so lousy. All right, very great. This has been a great one. That's it.